bring about the possible end of the Second World War and the Third Reich's collapse. So I think it's innocent, and it's right. And it won't help Putin. It demonstrates to Ukrainians and to the rest of the world what Ukraine is fighting for. I won't give you a blow-by-blow account of the Battle of Bakhmut, but I think if we were having this discussion here in Davos a year ago, I would have told you the invasion is coming, as I told the Munich Security Conference. But my working assumption would have been, frankly, that Ukraine would lose the invasion and then win a 10-year guerrilla war. Because I would have assumed with the rest of the world and with President Putin that he had a first class army. And we now know that he has a 20th century army with 19th century logistics. And that the Ukrainians were able to win the Battle of Kiev, win the Battle of Kharkiv, win the Battle of Kherson. There is a stalemate now because both sides have insufficient forces to progress. The classic Belgian calculus is that to advance you need 3-1 advantage, but in a built-up area you need between 5-1 and 7-1. And Putin started this war with insufficient forces. The last component was 120,000. Think about it. That's the size of a large American football stadium. And Ukraine is a country bigger than France. And we know what we don't know what is cooking with the training of this mobilized people and purchasing of other weapons. But what we do know is that wars are not won or lost by tactical engagement. Wars are won by logistics and production. And I think it's fair to say that if Ukraine had not been helped by the United States and Europe and some of the states, it might have fallen. But this war is being sustained thanks to both financial and military help from Ukraine's friends and allies. And so, given that Putin still thinks he can win, it's really crucial to speed up deliveries now, to play not for a draw, but for Ukraine to win this thing. And by winning, I mean restoring control of internationally recognized borders. So I think it's really vital for the German government to finally decide to create this consortium of countries owning Leopard 2s. There are, I understand, about 10,000 of them in NATO. If each of the owners put up 20-30% of what they have with German repair facilities and a logistical line of spare parts, that would help Ukraine go on the offensive, hopefully win the war, and then we could have some kind of new deal with Russia. That would be my preferred scenario.
We'll turn to that long term, but I next want to go to Yevhen to talk a bit about one of the other things that has surprised observers in the rest of the world over the course of the last year, which is the morale of Ukrainian forces and the resilience of Ukrainian society. You thought deeply about the reasons for that, and have seen this in a much longer time frame than I think most of us observing it. What accounts for that, and what ways do you see it being tested right now? What worries you, or what gives you hope that you look to the next several months?
Well, Ukraine has been probably one of the most mission-driven countries in the world. If you look through, for instance, the international ratings, Ukraine's institutions usually score around 150th place out of 200 countries. Ukraine's infrastructure usually scores around 100th place out of 200 countries. Ukraine's human capital usually scores around 50th place. So it's the human capital that matters. But the optics, particularly Western optics, of Ukraine was usually institutional, not human. So the institutional dimension was showing Ukraine didn't perform well through the entire time since 1991. And it was the human dimension that mattered, that was important. And when we're talking about human dimension, we forget that Ukraine is a modernized nation, it's an industrialized nation, it's a nation that has experience of dealing with sophisticated issues in a sophisticated way. When you have all of these factors playing in, and then put on top of that deep utilitarian trauma that actually allows Ukrainians to operate beyond the domain of formal institutions, deep colonial trauma that allows Ukrainians to have this guerrilla mentality, and deeply rooted survival values, you have a perfect mixture for the guerrilla layout that we have in Ukraine. Now, it's great that Ukraine performed much better than we expected, because if you would have talked about the scenario that Sikorski just voiced of a year ago, you know, 10 years of guerrilla war is devastating for everyone. So we are where we are right now, but it's crucial right now for us to end this war in 2023. And the reason why it is crucial is because we do not want to test the sustainability of Ukraine's resilience. We do not want to deepen the trauma. The trauma that we are, Ukrainians are on the receiving end of trauma right now, on top of the trauma that already exists. And that basically means that the resilience is absolutely incredible, but it's not endless. And working under assumption that, you know, political process in whatever country, you know, needs time to come to some conclusions, we do not necessarily have that time. And I think it's important that we do not go into another winter of infrastructure deaths and suffering, human suffering that is connected to that. So I think it's crucially important that every party that is available presses their respective governments at this point, if Ukraine gets enough, to conclude the military conflict in the year of 2023. If we go beyond that, we're going into uncharted waters, and then different scenarios are possible.
They are better than historically they have. I went to Kiev in October to deliver a pickup truck to Anna from the Hanover Hill, the 63rd Brigade, and went back to Poland in my own car and got a speeding ticket. And I said, well, can I pay it? Oh, no. We don't handle cash to go to the local bank. So it's
great. But let me go to you to collect another dimension of the question of statement. Western unity, I think, has also been relatively surprising to most observers over the course of the past year. To the extent that we have any insight into Vladimir Putin's mind and his calculations, he seems to be betting that it will start to falter, will start to fragment. How do you see the state of this, both in your own politics, both in Europe, interaction with the U.S.?
By way of answering that question, I think it's more relevant. I mean, I do try to speak with Western Ukrainian State Parliament, I love it too as well. More relevant to the debate is our question of the PhD in Western Ukraine. What is Western Ukraine doing? The media is actually a conflict. We just started this process after the Orange Revolution of the failure of Yevhen Hlibovtsky and the secretary of administration. For 8 years, second stage of the war, the paramilitary operation. They are being moved from the politics, the economics, the corruption, the oligarchy into the paramilitary scenario, as in Abkhazia, as in South Ossetia, as in Transnistria. That failed, and then you had this very, very sloppy, through the 1950s, Hungary, Czechoslovakia, style, quasi invasion, which for those of us who studied the oppressive immorality of Russian hybrid war is very done. That's what's the origin of the strategy. That's why you can be abandoned also. Secondly, to make Ukraine drive it out, destroy infrastructure. That's a Syrian value, targeting hospitals, you know, the creation of refugees, the weaponization of refugees. They hold the line, you pass Ukraine's willingness to fight, which, as you said, keeps them out of the country. And the third is the center of gravity. Russia wins and Russia loses. That's the critical point. The Ukrainians have to break the Russian line. Because if we're still here in 2 years, the world will start to give up. The Ukrainians may start to give up the fight because they won't be able to trade. Because all the people have to do is trash the Ukrainian economy for a long time. 25 years. That's what he has to do. He's got 150,000 new troops. They've lost anything like what the Ukrainians are playing. I think it's probably not that far off the loss of this record. But that's why Putin is building strong. I think words are important to supply, but there is no escalatory reason why we haven't supplied more regulated yet. But the Ukrainians are still having to choose between protecting civilians and protecting their infrastructure. This would be their choice. What the Brits are trying to do is because America is still the arsenal of democracy as it was in World War II Congress. What the Brits are trying to do is set the leadership example, take lead from the Russians, and say, right, we're giving, here's our startup, a promising startup, here's our first sort of, you know, startup capital in the form of 40 Chinese banks. I'm quite tempted that we haven't got that yet. But by us taking the political risk back, that means the Germans can sign off to allow the Poles, who are dealing with the Russians and us, to give this to the Danes, to give them, the Austrians, to give them, the Canadians, to give them. And then start that process. What the Brits are trying to do is some kind of political leadership with some capital. But you know, America is trying to do this in this year, and it's the Americans that really need to build that German defense system. You've got to start doing it. Not just for yourself, let others do that, because there are enough numbers to do this.
On a small point, the Russian soldiers started mutiny and shooting their own officers in World War I in year 3.
We actually, I think it's important that we actually look at the cultural side of the equation with impunity Russia as well. The Russian society has been subjected to tremendous pressure of propaganda, of oppression of human agency, and we see the results. You know, people actually go and end up being slaughtered for nothing. And it takes time for awakening to happen. So basically, the best thing the world can do at this point is help Ukraine to push the very awakening button that there is, and that is Crimea. The social contract in Russia assumes that Russians can suffer for this greatness, but if this greatness is no more, and this is about Crimea, if Ukraine liberates Crimea, then Putin will be faced with the bill from society much sooner rather than later. And basically, if we want to catalyze the internal domestic issue in Russia, if we want to see the Russians standing up against Putin or against Putin eventually, then the best way to do it, the best way to speed it up, is to liberate Ukraine.
Sorry, that is, if you look at, I know you are progressed on this, but that simply is not going to happen. Because there's not going to be Ukrainian military with a crossing conflict.
Have you looked at the map?
We
also have Ukrainian troops on the left bank.
I just think that is an unrealistic discussion. That's the best example of what we've been before this year. I think we have to realize that the lines will be, if the Ukrainians are going to break through, it is not going to be north of Crimea. It is much more likely to be south of and southeast of Zaporizhia or your island like that. But there's an exhaustion in the Russian supply. Even then, you're dealing with it. You're not going to have 50,000 Russian troops in the Ukraine.
This is exactly the point is that look, so far Ukrainian military command has been quite good at being outsmarted by using the resources that Ukrainians have at hand, not necessarily in the best composition, using the forces that Ukrainians have, using the culture that Ukraine has to their disposal, understanding the motivation of the fighting force on the other side. The issue is, if we do not liberate Crimea this year, we all, every one of us, are going to end up in much worse situation. And our discussions about the percentage of inflation or about the supply chain problems of today will look funny from the perspective of 2024-2025. So I'm asking everyone to be selfish, and not for the sake of Ukraine, but for the sake of your own economy, your own comfort of life, your own plans that you have with your families and so on. How can this work fast?
Let me stick with that because, you know, as you well know, when you have a discussion about Ukrainian victory or liberation in a think tank in Washington or in Berlin or in London, you immediately get the question of what victory means. And even been used in
the just for climate change, no, really? How do it from the Ukrainian side? This is the war of survival. This is the existential war of Ukraine.
But you know, that is not the issue. The issue is for Russia to win.
Any Chinese activity against Taiwan to the point that
course, it doesn't make sense. If Ukraine will have the support of the West in victory over Russia,
not that means that both things should happen. Ukraine should win and Russia should be defeated. We're not talking about some hypothetical victory if Ukraine that doesn't lead to the defeat of Russia. Russia should be defeated. If Russia is defeated, then we probably spare ourselves of a more significant conflict elsewhere. If we do not do that, then we actually leave the things as they are, and let's pray to God and hope that something will happen and you will be miraculously
fine. Brandon, let me go to you. There are about 6 points that I would ask you to respond to, but you have your pick.
So, first of all, Russia can be defeated. It doesn't mean the occupation of Moscow. It's adding the closest parallel to the Russian-Japanese war. Russia failed. And the revolution, right, there was a mediation by taking those words. And what followed in Russia, this is the most interesting part, is relatively free press, the establishment of parliament, and constitutional monarchy. That's what we want for Russia to lose and then liberalize.
And then 12 years later, it was the revolution of the
which wouldn't
without
I mean, that was a bit unfair. You would have had a slow move, right? It's absolutely right. I would also say the Crimean War is a great example. When Russia loses, it goes through either state collapse or state upheaval. And clearly, we want it to go through that good state upheaval because peace is great in freedom of Russia.
But I have two other more points to make. First of all, I think you're both right. The question is, for whom is time played? On which side is time? And what's kicking in is the fact that our sanctions are beginning to work on depriving the Russian economy of resources. We don't know how quickly they'll work, but they're beginning to bite. It's a fact. Event. And thirdly, I completely agree with you. If I were Ukrainian, I would be keen to be Russian occupied territory to pass. And that's what I would fear if I were Putin. If I were Putin, I would be trying to cut off the Western supply line and try to open the northern front from Belarus. And this is where I think we could be doing more. We are not doing enough to draw Russian forces away from Ukraine. We should be exercising in the Far East, we should be exercising in the Far North, we should be exercising in the Baltic states. We should be telling Lukashenko, at least as a threat, if you open the northern front, Ukraine, we will open the northern front too. Let him worry about it. The Russians have been saying the years that NATO is a threat to them, but the way in which they use their missiles and the way in which they position their forces shows that they have absolute certainty that there is no threat to them from NATO. And we should, Stalin apparently decided to close down the winter war with Finland when he heard there was British Spitfire in Azerbaijan. We need to create something like that.
I think you may well be right in the chair, from a personal point of view. I think the fact that it's been quite careful to stick it for the rest of the business is because if Putin thinks that the other way to get ties to the rest of the business, why the confrontation is well, because they always think why give Putin to the war if he's got a war of exercise and true exercise of the Russians. And I think that is rightly or wrongly clear about the Western policy. The answer,
I agree we should keep it as a proxy war, but they should not be certain. Yeah. They should not be certain of our intentions.
I think what actually, I think Belarus is critical. I think Lukashenko is scared that if he commits his weakened people forces for any North occupation, that's the end of his regime. And that's what we need to figure out to Lukashenko, that we will do everything we can to undermine him. So effectively, like in 1944, the Russians will have to invade Belarus to stop the collapse of his regime. That is and that is something that we are worried about, and that may be the reason why Belarus won't get involved because of the threat of regime collapse. And instead of having all three, Russia, Belarus, and Ukraine, in an Islamic sort of Moscow-like controlled community, he will lose Belarus as well as lose the state. So that's absolutely the best. Yeah, I want to go back to you because there's one thing that I think we've crossed over a bit and get into some of these military strategic questions.
that actually Ukrainians can't get enough assistance from the West, and then they will be looking for extra power, extra resources from their national character, similarly to how the Israelis are doing this. You know, they're taking that extra energy from their will. And that means they're going to be much more radicalist, they're going to be much more extremist, there's going to be much more people who are willing to sacrifice themselves, and you're going to see a significant increase in violence. And this is something that we want to avoid. So whenever the Western population is behind the schedule, and it's behind the schedule since 1990, let me remind you. In 1990, the West didn't believe the Soviet Union would collapse. When Frank Talbot and the company were designing Budapest Memorandum, etc., they never thought that Russia should be stripped of nuclear arms. You know, Ukraine was stripped of rockets that Ukraine now badly needs as a result of that agreement. Now, you know, when we're discussing the necessities on the ground, when we're discussing, you know, the Ukraine strategy, like we are discussing right now, there's a clear disconnect because Ukrainians are forced to understand by the nature of survival, Ukrainians are forced to understand the situation as it is. But at the same time, for instance, the Western analysts are not coming from Washington to Ukraine. Do you know why? Because their employers are afraid of multi-million suits. So they are saying, stay stick to Warsaw, you know, don't go to Ukraine. So as a result, when I, you know, and this is, as I was saying, the changes in Ukraine first happen to informal, and then they go to a formal sector. So basically, the result is that people in London, people in Washington, people in Berlin get delayed understanding of what's happening. And that's further complicated situation. So I think what we need greater integration. We need a more, a less colonial, more partnership layout of relations between the West and Ukraine. It's two-way speed. You know, we're together in this. We're protecting the same values. And sometimes Ukrainians are forced to believe that Ukrainians protect Western values more than people who actually enjoy the benefits of these values. And this is not a good situation. We have to fix it from both sides.
Let me go to Radek and Bob, and then we'll go to comments and questions from people in the room.
Not in the West is the fine sport, which I love with pleasure frequently, but let's also remember that you have 25 years of predatory corrupt Ukrainian government, which were not making the choice between Russia and the West, and in fact wasted a lot of time. I can't tell you how many times I went to Kiev, and I couldn't get a serious answer from my Ukrainian counterpart, because they thought they were playing some big game between the United States, China, Russia, European Union, and what they were actually doing is wasting time. Not making the choice that we integrate with Europe. We've made this choice really in the last 10 years. Good. But let's not integrate this. It was the Brits and the Americans and the Russians.
remotely, your head of military intelligence on a number of occasions in London, in Kiev, and they did the work of the war against the military population. They had done that again in the summer of 2022. So, did the West let Ukraine down in some way? I'm sure it did. But actually, Ukraine's strategy has been for a long time, and it's only since 2014 that the volume of the Ukraine has changed before. The massive changes. On a positive note, Odessa is still badly used in the campaign, but you know the really amazing change is not in the structure of the building, it's not in the paintwork, it's actually in the front of the building. And that has, since 2018, fundamentally. When you talk about value, you are spot on, but your political interest really is in that political view, and I'm not sure that
you do. Well, let me break on all three of us to the common denominator. First of all, we indulge in mocking the West to the extent that we indulge in mocking ourselves. So I think this is fair, that makes it fair. The other thing is, I would fully agree, you know, if we talk about independence as the ultimate form of agency, then Ukraine probably has become independent in 2014, not 1991. 1991 was a short window of opportunity when we escaped from Gulag, we escaped. And then we went through a very painful transformation with post-Soviet elite, with paternalist social contract, with, you know, and that ended in 2014 with a new agency that was proclaimed. It was not instantly recognized, it was not instantly recognized as such, but eventually we got to the point where we are right now. So when we are talking, then the other thing, which I think is crucially important, it's very important that Zelensky represents the political movement that had one of its electoral cores among the pro-Russian voters. Because the similar transition that Zelensky has gone through, his voters have gone through. So in the end, everyone is on the same page. You know, I am from Western Ukraine, so it's, you know, from my point of view, we knew that there's going to be the war with Russia, you know, before everyone started talking about it. You know, we knew about that for generations, you know, since the time of Ukrainian insurgent army, since the Second World War. But it was very difficult to transfer this message, to relate this message to our compatriots, you know, elsewhere. And so we had similar frustrations, you know, and I understand what you're saying, that they didn't believe, you know, my friends didn't believe, my relatives in Eastern Ukraine didn't believe, you know, so I understand it.
Let me go to others in the room for comments. We have a few minutes left. You can start from the first one over there. There's a mic.
First of all, excellent panel. Comment on Crimea. If Ukrainians have all the land bridge to Crimea, Crimea becomes an island and it would be almost impossible to defend the land bridge. And the question that I have is when those who want to support the idea of giving more weapons to Ukraine, what do you hear about? Because for me it's different to understand the logic. Once EMARs are there and other advanced systems are there, what is so sort of special about weapons or about long range artillery? You can take EMARs from the Russian border and do that. So, what is the argument for that?
Bob, rather, give that to me.
I don't know what the argument is, but the reality is that we are still supplying Ukraine from stocks. And I'm told that the new contracts we need for the production of more ammo are not being signed. I'm told that, you know, we're almost a year since Chancellor Scholz's transformation speech, and they still haven't spent a single euro of the promised 100 billion euro for rearmament. Oh, wow, well, that's not good enough. I think the base of weapons have been
so we have to get that kit from the front line of Ukraine, get it back to the right place to do it, and when you're running
Ukraine. We are explaining to Ukrainians that the West is doing a lot. But being here, we can't tell not tell you that it is very frustrating to see that we are will receive in several months patriots, which were on the place in the stocks in Germany, in Netherlands, in the United States 1 year ago. And if we would receive them in summer, there would not be so powerful attack against our power grid. We will not lose so many people, and so on and so on and so on. And that was already, that weapon was in the hands of the West, and it was not delivered to Ukraine. It's very frustrating. But the question is why? And I think what I feel, that the, almost everybody I speak with in the West, they want Ukraine to win. But many of them are afraid of Russia to lose. And that is something that Kissinger said in his article, that Russia is evil, but it is like an important part of equilibrium. Not even important, but eternal part of equilibrium. But it is not, in reality. And that, I think, is the reason why the West is afraid to give us more in the pace which is needed to finish this war as quickly as possible. And that this debate is not enough in the West. Speaking about what will be after Russian defeat and Russian collapse, that will be a lot of challenges, but that not, will not be a catastrophe. What do you think about this? Thank you.
Let me give each of you a quick chance to answer, but I want to go to Anna just to give her a chance to take part. Thank you for joining us and condolences on the carefulness this morning. Yeah, do you want to say anything about that?
Just one thing that I want to say. Can you give me this message to deal with preparing this crisis with crisis? You prepared no crisis. And you were saying that back then that the elites that were involved in this conflict were generally afraid. I'm afraid that not enough people feel this sense of urgency. There is no change if there is no sense of urgency. And I think what we should work on is to sustain this sense of urgency in the West for as long as we can to make sure that this war ends swiftly and eventually with Ukrainian victory and Russia.
Okay, that's a great question. Thank you so much for all your organizing us and the
We are in the West engaged in magic and wisdom. And unfortunately, Kissinger is very good people, he's all part of that. But we want Ukraine to win, and we somehow don't want Russia to lose. So if Ukraine to win, Russia has to lose on the battlefield. We are scared of Russia to lose because and it's not a small amount of people that are in the world. But we always think that Putin won't do that win. We always think that Putin won't let them lose. That is why we fear Russia to lose, because we fear that escalation as an outcome.
I don't think that's the reason for this vote. This is the largest Western assistance to any country in history. The Americans have voted for 50,000 billion already. We, as the European Union, have voted just on the financial side, 18 billion, 3 billion of which was wired yesterday. Member states that also have assistance programs and in fact are responsible for weapons delivery. This level of support, I think it would be safe for you to assume will not increase. But we need to sustain and we need to translate it into the right kind of equipment. But you have to win with this huge amount of assistance, which is, you know, in the region total of
back and then going to the title of this session. Yevhen started this conversation by saying we really needed big thing this year, the 2020 pandemic to be here. Do you share that sense of urgency? And what do you think the prospects are for Ukraine's success and sustainment of that for the next 18 months?
The combination of that is
from
the Yeah.